You're at 26240-26288, Gratiot Avenue, Rossville, Michigan.
They've been on strike since October 5th. In Michigan radio weather, rain showers in West and Mid-Michigan today. In the southeast, increasing cloudiness with a chance of rain. We'll have highs from the mid-40s to the low 50s. I'm Mike Perini, and you're listening to Michigan Radio News.
Support for NPR comes from NPR stations. Other contributors include the Joyce Foundation, committed to advancing racial equity and economic mobility for the next generation in the Great Lakes region. Learn more at joycefdn.org. And the Annie E. Casey Foundation.
This is Fresh Air. I'm Dave Davies in for Terry Gross. We're going to remember former Senator Max Cleland, a Vietnam War veteran and triple amputee who rebuilt his life after the war by dedicating himself to public service. He died Tuesday at the age of 79. Cleland earned a Bronze Star and Silver Star in combat, then entered politics in 1970, 2 years after he was injured, winning a seat in the Georgia State Senate. He went on to head the Veterans Administration under President Carter, then became Secretary of State in Georgia for 14 years. Cleland served one term as a Democratic senator from Georgia, but when he ran for re-election in 2002, Republicans led by consultant Karl Rove, who hand-picked his opponent, Saxby Chambliss, questioned Leland's patriotism and implied he was soft on the war on terror. In his memoir, Heart of a Patriot, How I Found the Courage to Survive Vietnam, Walter Reed and Karl Rove, Leland wrote that in his mind, he replayed the grenade explosion again and again that blew away both legs and his right arm. He found solace by immersing himself in politics and public service. But when he lost his bid for re-election to the Senate, he wrote, he fell into a deep depression. Leland returned to Walter Reed Hospital, where counseling, medication, and veterans, including those from Iraq and Afghanistan, helped him heal. In 2009, he was appointed Secretary of the American Battle Monuments Commission by President Obama. Terry Gross spoke with Max Cleland in 2009 when his memoir was published.
Max Cleland, welcome to Fresh Air. Would you describe your memory of what happened on the grenade that injured you blew up?
Well, I had, was April 8, 68. Sun was beginning to shine. Monsoons, I thought, were over. We were overlooking the Khe Sanh base, and the siege was broken that day. Our infantry battalion with the 1st Air Cavalry Division was moving into the Khe Sanh perimeter and needed a radio hookup on top of a mountain, and I went to do that because I was the signal officer for that unit. I took a team and tried to set up the signal operation there, but one of my men got off a chopper and dropped the grenade unbeknownst to me, and I saw it. I turned around, I had my M16 in my left hand and my steel pot on, my flak vest on, and I reached down with it to get it with my right hand because thinking it might have dropped off my web gear because I had grenades and everybody had them, and so the thing went off.
You didn't know that the pin was out.
No. And so, boom. I looked down, and my right hand was gone, and the bone was sticking out from the right. And then my right leg was gone, and my left leg was so badly shattered it was amputated within the hour. I mean, I could see it off to the left, and my boot, I felt this massive burning sensation. I couldn't speak because shrapnel had fractured my windpipe, and I was calling for help. Couldn't stand up, and you know, the guys on the hill ran toward me, started cutting off my uniform. I thought, how odd, you know, somebody cutting off my uniform. There I was laying, dying, burning, smoking, as a matter of fact, because I was so close to the flash burns of the grenade that it seared my flesh, which is why I didn't bleed to death right there on the hill. And within 15 minutes, I was in the Division 8 station, and the aide gave me a shot of morphine. I said, you think I'm going to make it? He said, you just might. In other words, my life hung by the balance, 50-50. And I was then flown to a Quonset hut where 5 doctors saved my life, only to ultimately face the question of why. why did I live? Why am I alive? What am I doing here? What's the meaning and purpose of life?
You know now that the grenade that blew up was the grenade of a fellow soldier. But you went through years thinking that it was your grenade, that you dropped a grenade, that somehow the pin was out of your grenade, and that you were responsible for blowing yourself up.
Yes.
How did you find out that that wasn't the case?
Well, by this time I was in the U.S. Senate, and I had done a program, I think, for the History Channel on combat medics, and I talked about this experience about, you know, picking up the grenade, and I thought it might have fallen off my web gear or something like that. The next day I got a phone call, and my secretary said, there's some guy on the phone, and a guy named Dave Lloyd said he was there on the hill when you got blown up. I said, well, put him through. He said, well, it wasn't your grenade. I said, how do you know that? He says, because I was the first to you. And I said, you were. And he said, yeah, I remember cutting your uniform off and using my weapon belt as a tourniquet on your left leg. And I said, only somebody that was there would have known that. So it wasn't my grenade, it wasn't my fault, and it was the fault of the I think a new guy who was getting off the chopper, and who had, after Dave Lloyd went to me, he went to the other guy and found out that he had grenades still with the pins loose, and that took them off of him because it was a walk-in time bomb.
So let's get to the existential crisis after this happened to you. You know, now you're, you have only one of four of your limbs left, and you have visions of flag lying on your back for the rest of your life. Your dream had always been to get into politics and become a senator. Before going to Vietnam, you'd been an intern for a senator, so you'd been to the Oval Office, you'd been to the Senate, and that's the life you wanted. So you decided to run for office. You ran for the state Senate and won. What was it like to campaign when you were so physically compromised?
Yeah, you got that right. In my first campaign in 1970, virtually immediately after I got my limbs, ultimately from the VA, as soon as I got home, I realized nobody's going to give me a job, nobody's going to do something for me, whatever. I was living at home with my parents. I said, this is not what I want. I'm 27, 28, and so, wait a minute, this isn't the life I envisioned, so I got to get up and do something. So I put on my artificial limbs. My mother and father helped me in the mornings. I went out. By then, I could drive a car. I had my hand controls on a car. And I wore my limbs, and I did my own campaigning, my own scheduling, my own money raising. I did it all from my mother's desk, for God's sakes. And I'm not sure how I did it, but it was really powerfully difficult. And I'd never seen anybody do anything like that. And I did it, though. And it wore me out. As a matter of fact, I would wear my limbs for about 6 hours, and I would start bleeding in my crotch and whatever. I mean, because they would wear me down. And it was plastic and leather and steel on my skin. So anyway, it was exhausting. But I had no other alternative if I wanted to get up and out. And believe it or not, nobody thought I could win. I wasn't sure I could win. And I started off way behind the eight ball. And nobody wanted to be the Democratic nominee in that suburban Republican county. So I got the Democratic nomination and did it out of the general election and became Georgia's youngest state senator at the age of 28, and its only Vietnam veteran. This was 1970. And during that campaign, I met a young man named Jimmy Carter. And as they say, the rest is history. In 1977, President Carter appointed me head of the Veterans Administration. I was 34.
And then when he was out of office, you were out of a job again.
Exactly. Yeah. So, back to Georgia, back living with my parents. This time, I did not wear the limbs. I campaigned in my wheelchair. And I can tell you, going up to somebody who has all their limbs, and me shaking out, shaking their left hand with my left hand, and I was right-handed, it's about as awkward as it gets. But ultimately, thank God, I won the Democratic primary and won the final general election. And I was Secretary of State in Georgia for 12 years.
You were thinking of running for governor of Georgia. And early on in that, I'm not sure if you officially declared yet or not. So you described this PR as the first political dirty trick against you. And I want you to describe the setup for that dirty trick. And it was dirty. Well, it's dirty in both meanings of that word.
Well, that's correct. By then, I had discovered vote sex, which wasn't bad. and a young lady that I was having some sex with, you know, she, unbeknownst to me, was friends with two adult males who were Republican, and they wanted to trap me. And because they saw me as a threat, running for governor. So I was embarrassed, apparently.
Missing
limbs or whatever, and they think, subconsciously maybe, less of them. They think that they are unable to perform certain tasks, not necessarily sexually, but just in general. Now, trust me, the fact that I'm human and an all-American male and still am, you don't want to particularly advertise that on a billboard or a TV shot, but you would assume that people would make that connection. However, a friend of mine told me after this incident that, well, this really helped you while we're down in South Georgia. So I said, oh, God. So it happened, but what I learned out of it was the fact that the other side
Senator Max Cleland speaking with Terry Gross in 2009. Cleland died Tuesday at the age of 79. We'll hear more of their conversation after the break. This is Fresh Air. Listening to Terry's 2009 interview with Vietnam veteran and former U.S. Senator Max Cleland. He died Tuesday at the age of 79.
Let's get to the campaign against you. When you lost your Senate seat in 2002 in a campaign against the Republican Saxby Chambliss, there's a very now famous ad that he ran against you and that he pulled and revised a little bit and then put back on the air. Would you first describe the original ad?
Well, keep in mind that I lost both legs of my right arm in Vietnam, and that Senator Chambliss never went to Vietnam at all. Matter of fact, got out by a number of deferments, wanted to trick me. So, to insinuate in any way that I was unpatriotic or not supportive of the country was criminal. And that's why I mentioned Karl Rove, because it was the Karl Rove strategy based on the Lee Atwater idea, which Karl Rove got from him, and that is that if you have weak positives, then you go after your enemy's negatives. You try, the whole purpose of a campaign is to drive your negatives, your opponent's negatives up, even after you have to go after their military service. Now, therein lies the problem. Now, anything one does in public life is fair game. I understand. I get that. But John Thomas Jefferson said public office is public property. I get that. But we're talking about military service here. This started out with McCain in South Carolina, where the five of us, the remaining Vietnam veterans of the Senate, all wrote a letter defending him against the attacks. Then the campaign against me in 2002, and then the Swift voting of John Kerry in 2004. That was all calculated to take away an asset that we possessed, namely our military service, and drive our negatives up. Now, the ad against me showed bin Laden, and then it showed Saddam Hussein, and their pictures and whatever, and then morphing into my face. Now, that's crazy. That's crazy to indicate that I had, or to look like I had anything to do with bin Laden or Saddam Hussein. It was nuts. But the insinuation was that I couldn't defend America, that somehow my votes in terms of amendments in committee on the Homeland Security Bill were somehow translated into not being able to defend the country. As a matter of fact, I was one of the sponsors of the Homeland Security Bill and fought for its passage. So all of that ad was basically a set of lies. But that's the extent to which those guys will go to win their elections.
Well, because of protests against that ad, the ad was modified so that explain how the visual part of it was modified.
The protest came from McCain and from Chuck Hagel.
Two Republican
senators, my colleagues in the Senate, and two fellow Vietnam veterans. And so supposedly the ad was modified a little bit, but the point was made. The point ultimately is that this, your military service should stand.
Well, I should say, in the modified ad, you were no longer visually...
But the damage had already been done.
How many times was it shown, the original one, before
you can't,
it was modified?
You can't not say that you're a liar. You know, you can't say, oops, I didn't mean that. So in so many ways, that shows what American politics has become. Bad campaigning results in bad governance.
Now, you're right that when you lost your Senate seat, your way of coping with life after Vietnam fell apart, that the pleasure of having a job worth doing and the money to keep you afloat were gone. You and your fiance broke up also, and it plunged you into this, like, terrible depression.
Right.
Can you talk about what it was like to lose your job, to lose your sense of purpose? I mean, the only real jobs that you'd had, you know, after the military and after you lost three of your four limbs, was elected office and then being appointed to the VA by President Carter. So, I mean, your life had been politics.
That's right. And I had used politics in public service, and I am public service. That's what I do. I'd used that as my way of coping, of my way of fitting back in, of my way of finding my place in life, in society. It was my way of earning an income, of having a little staff around me, of having an office, of something, of a place to go to, you know, a way to survive. So politics became that for me. When I lost it, I lost everything. I lost my way of coping, only to find myself hitting bottom in every way in which you can hit bottom, and finding myself back at Walter Reed in PTSD counseling, in massive depression, dealing with how in the world am I going to get a grip on my life anymore.
Do you feel like you've been able to make peace with yourself, peace with the fact that what happened happened, peace with the fact that your body is so compromised and that you can't have what average people with average bodies have. Have you been able to make peace with that, or does it still make you angry every day?
I have my anger. I have my deep anger. When I see people running laps up and down the street, I wish I could do that. I try to do my own little laps in my apartment on pillows and stuff. I wish I could do that. I wish I could do a whole host of things I used to be able to do. So I think that makes it more important what I can do. And what I could do was run for public office and do those kind of things. When I couldn't do that anymore, then that's really when I hit bottom, emotionally and spiritually. But I'm coming out of it because I've been there. I've been to a place where I didn't want to live anymore. And I understand that place, but it's not ultimately true.
As the former head of the Veterans Administration under President Carter, do you feel like you get adequate veterans benefits now?
I do. Now, the guy's coming back and gal's coming back. Boy, who can replace what they have lost? Who can minister to their needs? They've seen war. They've been part of war. And we have a whole host of things we need to do. And that healing for them really has only just begun.
But do you think they're getting adequate benefits?
It's not so much a question of benefits as it is...
Or care.
The question of did what I do have any meaning and purpose for the America that I love? That's the question. And so they'll be spending the rest of their lives trying to establish that meaning.
Well, it sounds like when you ask yourself that question in terms of Vietnam, your answer is no, not really.
That's correct. But I'm still here, you know, I'm still alive, and I try to make the best of it.
Former U.S. Senator Max Cleland spoke with Terry Gross in 2009 when he just published his memoir, Heart of a Patriot, How I Found the Courage to Survive Vietnam, Walter Reed and Karl Rove. Cleland died Tuesday at the age of 79. Coming up, the battle to keep independent local journalism alive. We'll speak with Art Cullen, editor of the Storm Lake, Iowa Times, whose paper is profiled in a documentary on PBS next week. I'm Dave Davies, and this is Fresh Air.
The Neubauer Family Foundation supports WHYY's Fresh Air and its commitment to sharing ideas and encouraging meaningful conversation. Support for NPR comes from this...